figure out how to celebrate the birth of Christ, and we are so glad to have you here to join us for our special program today. The choir is going to be presenting most of it, and then Brother Matt is going to be closing us out today. So we appreciate you all. I mean, how many is glad to be in the house of the Lord this morning? Please stand. We got to hear our congregation this morning too for a few bars. So we're going to be doing the First Noel.
The first Noel, the angels did say, "What's your servant, poor shepherd, in fields and..."
seated.
Just making sure it wasn't me. Good morning. I'd like to take this time to welcome you to First Baptist Church Trenton. I'd like to welcome you all here in person and those online as well. Just a couple of announcements this morning. If you are a youth parent and your student is planning on going to Strength to Stand, we'll have just a very brief meeting in the gym at the conclusion of the service. Remember, there are no services this Wednesday or the following Wednesday or next Sunday. Our next service after this morning will be Christmas Eve at 5 o'clock. Again, I'd like to say welcome and thank you for being here. Let me open us up in a word of prayer before we hear from Brother Steve and the choir. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this day. We thank you for everything that you've given us, Lord. We thank you for your Son, Jesus, who came to be born in a lowly manger so that one day he might be crucified on the cross at Calvary for our sins. So I ask you to help us to keep the manger to the cross in mind this season. You know, we pray. Amen.
It sounded like a typical night on the outskirts of Bethlehem. The bleating of sheep, wind rustling through the grass, yawning shepherds fighting to stay awake at their posts. But this run-of-the-mill night would soon turn extraordinary as the skies burst with the most beautiful song. The angel of the Lord was bringing news, joyful news.
Star of Bethlehem, shine on.
Suddenly, those sleepy shepherds were jolted awake, hearts pounding with fright. But the angel said, "Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest." When the choir of angels returned to heaven, the shepherds said, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see for ourselves what the angels have told us about it." So they hurried off to find Mary and Joseph and the baby, the infant Savior King, not in regal garb, not in a palace, but in swaddling clothes in a dusty stable behind an overcrowded inn.
Come adore the King, come adore they were all gone, Mary was pondering the events of the day. It was hard to believe that Almighty God had entrusted her with such a big job.
The shepherds returned to their flocks, glorifying and praising God for all they had seen and heard. Oh, may we, like them, be ever filled with awe that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son to be our Savior.
Worship Christ the newborn.
Thank you, Brother Steve, and thank you, choir, and Mr. Mark, and the kids. That was wonderful, wasn't it? If you have your Bibles, go ahead and turn to Matthew chapter 2. I just want to speak with you just very briefly for a few minutes about three things we can glean from the visit of the wise men. We're very blessed here at First Baptist Trenton to have musicians and vocalists and everybody to be able to do these things, because I know many churches struggle to find people to get up on the stage. So I just want to say thank y'all very much. I really enjoyed that. So as we look, and I don't have my headset on, so I'm going to try to do this and be still the whole time. I'm a teacher by profession, so Briley can attest that when I talk and lecture in class, I walk laps in my classroom. So I'm going to try to do that right here today. But we're going to look at Matthew chapter 2. If you would stand in the honor of reading God's word, if you're able, and then I will pray. Beginning in Matthew chapter 2, verse 1. It says, "Now after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king, behold, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem, saying, 'Where is he who has been born king of the Jews? For we saw his star when it rose and have come to worship him.' When Herod the king heard this, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. And assembling all the chief priests and scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Christ was to be born. They told him, 'In Bethlehem of Judea, for so it is written by the prophet, and you, O Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means the least among the rulers of Judah, for from you shall come a ruler who will shepherd my people Israel.' Then Herod summoned the wise men secretly and ascertained from them what time the star had appeared, and he sent them to Bethlehem, saying, 'Go and search diligently for the child. And when you have found him, bring me word that I too may come and worship him.' After listening to the king, they went on their way, and behold, the star that they had seen when it rose went before them until it came to rest over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they rejoiced exceedingly with great joy. And going into the house, they saw the child with Mary, his mother, and they fell down and worshiped him. Then opening their treasures, they offered him gifts, gold and frankincense and myrrh. And being warned in a dream not to return to Herod, they departed to their own country by another way." Let's pray. Heavenly Father, as we come before you today, open our hearts and minds to what you would have us get today. In your name we pray. Amen. So in the last few weeks on Wednesday nights in youth, we have been looking at different perspectives of the Christmas story. We looked at Mary and Joseph, we looked at the shepherds, and we even looked at the three wise men. So there are three things that we can get from the wise men and their visit to Jesus. In verse 2 it says, "Now after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king, behold, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem, saying, 'Where is he who has been born king of the Jews? For we saw his star when it rose and have come to worship him.'" Piggybacking off of what Brother Don said last week, these magi or maori in the Arabic term would have been educated men. They would have been astrologers. They would have studied the night sky, and that's what how they would have come to seen the star. They would have known the prophecies because they'd have been educated of all things. And so these men were very well off. They were very wealthy. To be educated in that day, you had to have some wealth to your name. And they would have been ones that kings and rulers sought out for their opinion. And so these three guys were very well off. And they come and they take a journey of hundreds of miles, some say thousands of miles. Back in those days, right now, you leave the creature comforts of home. If you travel that far now, you're going either by train or a plane or maybe even by car. But everybody here knows it's not as comfortable as home. So the first thing we see from the wise men is that sometimes when you go to meet Jesus, you have to leave your comforts behind. See, God does not leave us in our comfort zone all the time. Sometimes he asks us to step out in faith, to go into a place that might be uncomfortable. Right? I'm a teacher by profession. I teach to 10 and 11-year-olds. I do not teach to adults very much. And I teach to the youth. So this is a little bit uncomfortable for me. And many of you, God has asked you to be in uncomfortable situations when He calls us to follow Him. The three wise men, some we say we three kings, we don't know how many there are. There could have been seven, there could have been two, we just know there were multiple ones. They left the comforts of home. They embarked on a long trek to meet Jesus. So the very first thing we can see is that Christ and following Christ often leads us outside our comfort zones. The next thing we see is that Christ often asks us for our very best. In verses 10 and 11, it says, "When they saw the star, they rejoiced exceedingly with great joy. And going into the house, they saw the child with Mary his mother, and they fell down and worshipped him. Then opening their treasures, they offered him gifts, gold and frankincense and myrrh." We know that these things right here, they are not cheap items for them to bring to Jesus, and they would have been the very best things that they had to offer. Like I said before, these would have been men that rulers and kings had come to for advice. And being in the presence of these rulers and these kings, these men thought that they were going to see this Messiah, this Christ, the coming King. And so when they thought of something to bring to baby Jesus, they thought of the very best that they could, the very best things that they could. They thought, we're going to see a King, so let's bring Him the very best that we can afford. The very best they could afford were gold and frankincense and myrrh. And so just like Cain and Abel in the Old Testament, these wise men bring home a point that God asks for our very best. He does not ask for the seconds. He doesn't ask for the things we have left over. God asks for our very best. And the thing about our very best is our very best oftentimes means different things to different people. My very best that I have might not be somebody else's very best. You don't want my very best singing voice, because I would not even belong on the stage with y'all if it was my very best. Brother Steve knows, he tried to get me in my last church to sing, and I said, I'll sing a solo. He said, great. I said, I'm going to sing solo that you cannot hear me, and we'll leave it at that. But I do not sing. My wife sings. My kids obviously sing a lot better. But that's not my very best. Our very best, and that could be your very best finances, the very best time that you have. Each and every person, that's what the beauty of Christ is, that Christ doesn't deal with us corporately. Christ deals with us individually.
Amen.
And Christ deals with us as my very best and your very best. But following Christ at the end of the day does require that we give Him our very best. And the final thing in verse 12, this is what Matthew writes. He says, "And being warned in a dream not to return to Herod, they departed to their own country by another way." The last thing I want us to understand from the three wise men and their visit means, actually it's two parts. The first one is a long time, is for those of us who know who Jesus is. When we meet Jesus face to face, sometimes it causes us to change our plans. See, these wise men had planned. Their plan was, when they came in, Herod said, hey, they didn't know anything about Herod. He said, hey, when you see the baby Jesus, come back and tell us where you find Him. When you tell us where you find Him, I want to go and worship Him. Now, we know from hindsight of 2,000 years of history that Herod did not have the best plans for the baby Jesus. But the wise men didn't know that when they met Herod. And their intention, their plan, was when they left baby Jesus, they were going back to Herod and were going to tell him. But having met the baby Jesus, the wise men's plan changed and they went home a different way. And that's for the Christians. But here is the point for those of you who may not know Jesus. When you truly meet Jesus Christ, you will never be the same. When you truly meet Jesus Christ, it is an impossible thing to meet Jesus, whether as a baby in a manger or the Savior on a cross, and not leave the way you came. So in this Christmas season, we need to think about all three of the things that we can learn from the wise men. First off, that sometimes as we follow Jesus, we will follow Him out of our comfort zones. Next, sometimes when God asks things of us, He doesn't want the second rate. He wants the very best that we have to give. And finally, when we meet Jesus, He causes us to not leave the way we came. He causes us to change our plans. So in this Christmas season, I want you to think about what that means for you. Where are you in your walk with Jesus? Where are you when you come to the foot of the cross? Maybe God is asking you to step out of your comfort zone. Maybe he's asking you that you've not been giving your very best. Maybe you need to begin giving your very best. Or maybe you've kind of fallen away, and when you meet Jesus at the foot of the cross, you will not leave the way you came. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I just thank you this day. I thank you for each person here, Lord. And as we just go about our Christmas season, I just ask that you be with each and every family here, that as we leave this place, that we follow you in comfort and honor, that we follow you and give you our very best, and Lord, that when we meet you face to face at the foot of the cross or at the manger, that we don't leave chained, that we don't leave the way we came. In your name we pray. Amen. I'd like to remind all the youth parents, we are going to have a very brief meeting in the gym right now, and at that, the next service here at First Baptist Trenton is 5 o'clock on December 24th. I hope you'll have a wonderful Sunday afternoon. You are dismissed.
Good job, y'all.